Assalamualaikum. So we are going to continue with the topic of signal design. The last step was remaining. We already discussed the phase in the ring diagram and then how to calculate the timings. Okay, the green time, the yellow time, the order time. Now we will discuss the pedestrian requirements. Okay, so first of all, you need to find out how much time is required by the pedestrians. The time required by the pedestrians is represented as GP. Okay, so GP is the green time required by the pedestrians. And again, a clarification which I made last time as well, but I will repeat it, that if I'm saying pedestrian is crossing in this direction, then obviously I will not time this green, the green time of this pedestrian with this vehicle, right? Okay, then they will be clashing with each other. So when I say green time for the pedestrian, then it should match with the vehicle which is going parallel to it, right? Okay, so this green time, this pedestrian will move in the green time of this vehicle and so on. Okay, so you have to look for the green in which the pedestrian can move and you will match it with that. Okay, so first of all, find out how much green time is required by the pedestrians, which is a combination of these two things. This is known as the passing interval, the minimum passing interval, minimum passing interval. And the second one is passing interval, and then we have the clearance time. For the passing interval, we have this table here. Okay, so if you have high pedestrian areas, then you will take it around 10 to 15 seconds. Okay, if you have typical pedestrian, so moderate volume, and a cycle length of 60 seconds or more, then you will take it 7 to 10 seconds. And if your cycle length is less than 60 seconds with moderate pedestrians, then you will take it 7 seconds. If you have very negligible pedestrian volume, then you may take it 4 seconds minimum. And if you have older pedestrians, then you will calculate the distance. You will calculate the time using distance upon speed. So calculate the width of the road, how much width they have to cross, and then you divide by 3 feet per second. So 3 feet per second is taken as the average speed for old pedestrians. For young pedestrians or pedestrians who are not old, it will be like 3.5 to 4 meter, feet per second. I think we discussed it in chapter 3 as well. So 3 feet per second. So for old pedestrians, you have to see if you have older pedestrians in more number, then you will calculate the minimum using this. Okay. Then once you put the value of minimum passing interval here, then the clearance time can be calculated using this. L is the length of the crosswalk. Again, the width of the road, basically, which they have to cross. And SP is the speed. Okay. The speed of the pedestrians. Okay, so as I said, there are standards for that, and the normal standard is 3.5 to 4. You can get the exact value from the other chapter we have discussed earlier. Once you get GPI or GP for any phase, I means the phase. Okay, so once you get the phase, the minimum pedestrian time required for a phase, then you have three options to match it with. Okay, you can match it with green plus yellow plus all red, or you can match it with green plus yellow, and you can only match it with green. And I'm talking about vehicle green and yellow and all red, okay? Not the pedestrian one. So pedestrian green time, option one is should be at least, so they are using less than equal to, meaning at least. So it can be equal to or less than this value. So pedestrian green time should be at least equal to green plus yellow plus all red, or it can be at least equal to green plus yellow, or it can be at least equal to green. Both of them are considered safe, but let me tell you what is the difference here. Green plus yellow plus all red, this is the total time of a phase. Once all red finishes, what happens after that? The vehicle from some other direction will start the green. The vehicle or some other phase will start the green. Okay, once you finish the all red time. Okay, so now, since you have already calculated GP, and GP has two parts, and now then you are saying, that this should be equal to this. Now, it may happen that one pedestrian is very weak or slow, or he is on a wheelchair, or he had some problem during the time when he was crossing the road. He was looking at the mobile or something, or he had a kid who was, teasing him or something. So because of that, he could not cross during this time. So then it becomes dangerous, right? Because if he cannot cross during this time, then some other vehicle will definitely come into his way. Okay, so there is no margin for him. There is no margin. As I said, this option is still safe because he already considered how much time he requires. So you are putting the time he requires to exactly the time of the phase, which is still fine. Okay, and they use it because this is at least. So it may be less than this time as well. So if it is less, then no problem. But even if it is equal, it is safe. But there is no margin here. There is no margin of error or no flexibility here. Because let's say you are this pedestrian and you could not finish, you could not cross even during the all red time, then what will happen? You may be few feet away from the other side of the road and the vehicle starts coming from the other direction or maybe this direction. Okay, so then you will have a problem. Okay, so there is no margin for extreme cases here, you know, there is no flexibility here. If you look for the other option, in the other option we are saying GP should be at least equal to G plus Y, green plus yellow. So now he has a margin of all red as well. So if GP is exactly equal to G plus Y, then he has still the all red time available to him. If he needs 1 or 2 seconds extra, they are there. Okay, no other vehicle will enter until the all red is closed, until the all red, you know, passes. And then third option, we have more flexibility because then you are putting GP only equal to G. So if GP is exactly equal to G, then he has the yellow time and the all red time and so on. Okay. So all of these options are safe. All of these options are applicable. Only difference is there's more margin in option 3 as compared to option 1. Okay, more flexibility you can say. Okay, but flexibility is not the design criteria. Let us look at an example. If pedestrian timings are not met, then what should we do? We have two phases here, green, yellow, and all red time for both the phases are given. Lost time is given and the pedestrian required green time is given for both the phases. And they are saying that the pedestrian time must match with capital G plus capital Y. And what is capital Y? I explained to you earlier as well. Capital Y is yellow plus all red. So they are using option 1 now. Option 1. Okay. They are not saying capital G plus small y. They are saying capital G plus capital Y, which is green plus Y plus yellow plus all red. Okay. Now, if you look at phase A, there is no problem. Pedestrian green time required is 20 seconds and phase A has 40 plus 3 plus 2, 45 seconds. Okay, no problem. Okay, look at phase B. Pedestrian requires green time 30 seconds. Phase B has 15 plus 3 plus 2, 20 total. Okay, so that means now we need to change the green time for phase B. Okay, now yellow and all red, I have already shown you the equations in the last lecture. And they will not change. Okay, we have already calculated them and they are fixed. So the only thing which we can change is phase time for B. Okay, currently it is 15 seconds and we need to change it so that green plus yellow plus all red makes at least 30 seconds. Now, while you are doing that, you have to keep one thing in mind. Okay, let me go step by step. The first step is while you are changing the green time, you have to look at the effective green time as well, and this is where it will make our life easier if we are using the HCM recommended values. HCM recommended values for lost time and the use time of yellow, which I showed you in the previous lecture. Okay, so if you are using those values, then yellow plus all red becomes equal to lost time. Yellow plus all red becomes equal to lost time. So capital Y is equal to lost time. So that means that effective green is equal to actual green. Okay, so if you are using HCM recommended values for the use time of yellow and the startup loss time, then capital Y becomes equals to loss time. Okay, so small g becomes equal to capital G. What is small g? Effective green. What is capital G? Actual green. So actual green is the time when the green light is shown, and effective green is the time during which vehicles are moving at saturation headway. So both these values will become equal. So our calculations will become easier. Okay, because then you don't have to calculate a small g separately. Okay, whatever value you're calculating for g, that will remain as it is. So this is the first thing you have to keep in mind. Now, so we need, for phase B, we need green plus yellow plus all red to be equal to 30. Green plus yellow plus all red to be equal to 30. Now, yellow plus all red is already 5 seconds. It's already 5 seconds. So to make green plus yellow plus all red equal to 30, I have to make green for B equal to 25, right? So 25 plus 3 plus 2 will become equal to 30 seconds. Okay, so this is the first thing we do. Okay, so this is the first step. Effective green is equal to actual green time, which is given. Okay, and now the required green time for B plus yellow plus all red should be 30 seconds. So Y, capital Y, yellow plus all red is already 5 seconds. So the required GB is 25 seconds. Okay, this is what we have said. Now, the problem is, if you only increase the green time of yellow, if you only increase the green time of phase B, then it will create a disbalance in your signal design. How? When you designed the signal, you said 40 seconds for A and 15 seconds for B. What happens when you are giving green time for one phase, the other phase has red time? Then during that red time, what will happen? During that red time, there will be a queue of vehicles on that, for that phase. So when you design the phase for 40 seconds, that means the queue which will arrive in phase A can pass easily during 40 seconds. Okay, and that queue arrived when the phase time for B was only 15 seconds. So in 15 seconds, let's say 10 vehicles come. So 40 seconds is enough for 10 vehicles. But if I increase the green time for B from 15 to 25, maybe instead of 10 vehicles, I will have 13 vehicles. So maybe 40 seconds is not enough for passing of 13 vehicles. Okay, and we have already discussed what happens if you do not pass the queue during the green time. You will have oversaturation, traffic jam, and then the delay will not be uniform. The signal will become over capacity and so on and so forth. Okay, so the point here is I cannot just increase the value of green time of phase B. I have to make a corresponding change in the phase time for A as well. Okay, so that the extra queue which will pile up in phase A will leave during that extra time. Okay, this 40 seconds was for the number of vehicles which will arrive when the B green time was this much. But if you increase the B green time, then there will be extra vehicles in the queue and I have to get rid of them in the green time of phase A as well. So the green time for phase A should also change. Now I already know the green time for phase B should be 25 seconds. This is done fine, no problem with it. Okay, how much change should I make in phase A? Actually, the phase B time will also change, but let me come to that point later on. So first of all, calculate the current cycle length. The current cycle length is 65 seconds. How? You add green and yellow and all red for all the phases. So green and yellow and all red for phase A and green and yellow and all red for phase B. You add them together, you get 65 seconds. Now here it is already rounded off to the 5 seconds, but whatever cycle length you will calculate later on, it must be rounded off to the nearest 5 seconds. I have already said that previously as well, and we have done that in the previous example as well. Now, if you are increasing phase time of A and B both, that means the overall cycle length will increase. So how to calculate the new cycle length? The old cycle length multiplied by the ratio of the new phase of phase time of A and phase time of B. Okay, the new cycle length multiplied by the ratio of the new green time of B upon the old green time of B. Okay, so 65 multiplied by 25 upon 50. 65 is the old cycle length, 25 is the new green time for B, and 50 is the old green time for B. So you get the cycle length 108.3 seconds. And then you round it off, it will become 110 seconds. Okay, so the new cycle length is now 110 seconds. From this cycle length, I have to divide it into two phases. Okay, phase A and B. Now, in terms of vehicles, I already calculated the green time here. Okay, so I'm increasing it, so vehicles do not have any problem now. My problem is to distribute this 110 seconds with the same ratio which in which they were distributed earlier. So 110 seconds, the total time, I will subtract the lost time. So lost time, you have two phases, you subtract the lost time for each phase. So phase A has 5 seconds, B has 5 seconds. So 110 minus 5 for A and minus 5 for B. So total green time available is 100 seconds. 110 minus 5 minus 5, total green time for B, for total green time for this cycle length is 100 seconds. Now this 100 second must be divided into two phases. So 100 multiplied by the ratio of the old green time of the phase divided by the total green time of the phase. The old green time of the phase divided by the total green time of all the phases. So 100 multiplied by 40, and I'm doing it for phase A. So 100 multiplied by 40, which is the old green time of A divided by the summation of green time, which is 40 plus 50. So 40 was for A and 15 was for B. So the new green time for phase A is 72.7 seconds. And for phase B, then 100 multiplied by 15, because 15 was the old green time of B, divided by 40 plus 15, which is the summation of green times with the previous timing. So it will give you 27.3 seconds. Okay, so the new green time for A is 72.7, and the new green time for B is 27.3 seconds. And again, this is actual green as well as the effective green, because yellow is equal to total lost time. Okay, so this is how you convert the, or you adjust the signal timing for pedestrians. Okay, let me repeat what I did. First of all, I should have the green time and the yellow time and the all red time and the total lost time for vehicles, and I should have the pedestrian green time. If it is not given, you calculate these things. Once you calculate, then you check. Okay, so when I checked, I found that phase B timing was not enough. I needed to increase it. I need to increase it from 15 to at least 25, because, you know, this is less than equal to, right? The criteria was less than equal to G plus Y. So at least 25 or more than 25. Now you can see in the end, I got 27.3. Okay, so I increase it even more. Okay, so I need to increase it to at least 25. So I increase it 20 to 25. So I need to make the corresponding change in the cycle length as well as the timing of phase A as well. So I first of all find out the current cycle length, multiplied by the ratio of the green times for phase B. I found the new cycle length, I subtracted the lost times, and then I found the new green time by multiplying the total green time available now with the ratio of the old green time of the phase divided by the total green times of the previous phases. Okay, and then you get the new timing of green time for each phase. Okay. Of this chapter, if you have a question, 65 seconds in this case was given. In this case, it was given. If you want to know how to calculate the cycle length, then we already did the example in the previous lecture as well as in the last chapter as well. Okay, 65 seconds in this example was given, but we have already seen how to calculate the cycle length in the previous examples. Okay. This example, obviously, I cannot solve the whole signal design in one class, so I have to do it in parts. Okay. So if you want to see the equation, go for the previous examples and the previous chapter as well. For this example, it is given. For this example, it was given. Okay. Our last chapter is about highway safety. This is taken from chapter 12. And we have discussed about highway safety previously as well in chapter 1. Okay, this is our top priority and the primary objective and so on. Let us look at some other statistics to clarify the issue, and then later on we will use this in our discussion as well. So you can see this is the data for 40 years of accidents from USA. So the first graph is only for fatal crashes, then for injury accidents, and then property damage accidents. Okay, so three different types of accidents, and the statistics are given. Now you can see one trend in all the three graphs, that the number of accidents are reducing. See this? The trend is reducing. Okay. Obviously, you will have some exceptional cases, some exceptional years, but the usual trend is decrease. Okay. In all the three graphs. Okay. So they have done some measures to make this happen. The usual trend of traffic crashes, although it's a big problem still, but the trend is on the positive side in most of the cases. So this is for USA. Now they investigated, the accidents happened throughout the country, and they found some things. Okay, so they found that these are the factors because of which number of accidents or severity of accidents can change. First of all, time of the day and day of the week. Weekdays and weekends have different number of accidents and severity of accidents. And we have also discussed that time of the day as well as days of the week also change traffic volume as well. Okay, so you can say they are interrelated. Traffic volume and accidents are interrelated. Then they also found that traffic accidents may also change because of weather conditions. They also change because of light conditions. So light conditions may also include the natural light as well as the artificial lights in the form of the light poles. Then type of road, we have RTDS, collectors, local streets, so on. Type of control devices you are using and the condition of the road, you know, the pavement condition, how well maintained it is, and so on and so forth. So these things also affect the accidents. Then nature of the accidents, okay. You can have head-to-head accidents, accidents from the rear side, accidents from the side, and so on. So they found that all these were different in different numbers, okay. Vehicles involved, okay. What type of vehicles were involved? Cars, trucks, and so on. And the condition of the driver, was he under some drugs or alcohol, or was he distracted or not? So they found these are the factors which should be studied for the accidents. Okay, these are the factors which affect having the accident and the severity of the accident. This is the accident data for Bahrain, and I could only find it from 2012-2018, and this was also collected by some students. Okay, and but still you can see the trend from 13 onwards, the trend is decreasing. It's going down. Okay, it's going down. Okay. So we are matching with the trend from USA or some other countries as well. Okay, I cannot show the data from all the countries, but the trend is usually decreasing. Then I had a detailed analysis done by a traffic engineer from Traffic Directorate, and he was kind enough. He was actually a former student. Okay, so he was kind enough to give me his findings. Okay, so he found that the place is Manama. The most critical place for accidents is Manama. Most of the accidents happen there. Most of the injury accidents happen during January. They happen mostly on Wednesday. The dangerous time is from 4 to 5 p.m. And most of the accidents happen during daylight time. Okay, they don't happen during night time. They happen during daylight time. And they happen due to the drivers. 97% of the accidents happen due to a driver fault. And most of the injury accidents are with old vehicles. New vehicles have less injury accidents compared to old vehicles, because maybe people are, you know, more cautious when they are driving newer vehicles, or that maybe newer vehicles have more features, safety features, and so on. Okay, so this can be the reason. What are the reasons of accidents? Common reasons are colliding with a pedestrian, and these accidents we have discussed earlier are more dangerous. Following too closely with the other car, so you are not maintaining the spacing between you and the other car, the headway of the spacing. So it results in rear-end crashes, rear-end accidents. Crossing of red light, obviously you are violating the red light, and you understand the consequences, right? You are all mature enough and adult enough. You know if you cross the red light, obviously you are interrupting some other traffic flow. Speeding, over-speeding. Over-speeding gives you less chance to react to any situation, and we'll discuss it later on as well. And obviously you are violating the design speed, so you are bound to have an accident. Changing the lanes carelessly. Okay, now this is something which I have seen only in case of Bahrain, that the traffic officer comes and he judges that some person may have changed the lane carelessly, because it's something subjective, right? I may say, okay, you change the lane carelessly, you change it when you were very close to me. Okay, because for other things we have standards, right? Following too closely, we have a standard how much distance you keep. Red light, you shouldn't cross a red light. Speeding, we have speed limits. But changing the lane carelessly is something you have to judge yourself. The traffic police officer will come and he will judge. Okay, this guy changed the lane carelessly. Okay, so but anyways, they found enough cases to say this is one of the major reasons of having the accidents. these are the reasons they found for 2018, but I have seen the other data from the previous years as well, and there's not much difference. There's not much difference here. Okay, you will find the same reasons even for 17 and even maybe even for 19 as well, 2019 as well. Now what has happened? So since I have shown you that traffic accidents are decreasing, why they are decreasing? Because the priorities of traffic engineers have changed. Okay, since we were having too many accidents in 70s and 80s and 90s, and even in the early part of 2000s as well. So we changed our priorities, we made some changes in our thinking and our methodology and our technology, okay, to have this effect, to have this change. What are these changes in priorities? First of all, you may have seen, I was saying accidents, because accident is a more common term for us. But in the slides, you can see they have written crashes. They did not say accidents, okay? In the books now, they are no longer using accidents. I just received the review of one of my papers, and the reviewer said, why are you using the term accidents? Because traffic accidents is no longer a term which is in use. They use traffic crashes or only crashes. Why? Accidents happen randomly, okay? If you go look in the dictionary of accidents, accidents happen randomly. Okay, and they may be unintentional and something which you cannot control completely. Okay, so you know, sometimes you are going like it happens with me. You know, I have taught in Pakistan for so many years. Sometimes I'm going around and I find a student just standing there, and he looks at me. He says, "Okay, I know you," and so on. We met by accident. It doesn't mean we bumped into each other and we injured each other. Okay, I did not do so bad. Okay, but what would be the term you use? The term you would use is, we met by accident. I met a friend in a park here, yeah. And he's an old friend. I just met him once. After that, I did not meet him. He is still here in Bahrain. I did not meet him. So at that time, we met by accident. That's it. Okay. So accident is something which is not considered harmful, first of all, and it is not considered with something which is in your control. But crashes is something to change the mentality that traffic accidents or crashes can be avoided. Crash is something which you can avoid. Crash is something which you can study. You can study the reasons and you can try to avoid it by making appropriate changes in the design and using the technology. So this is the first change in the mindset that we start to think that accidents, traffic accidents, can be avoided and should be avoided, must be avoided. Okay. So obviously you can avoid it to some extent because people are involved. So many factors are involved. So you cannot make them zero, but this is a change in thinking. Okay, that you should try to avoid it. You cannot neglect or leave anything out. Then the shift to include pedestrians and bicyclists. We have discussed this in chapter one as well. This is a paradigm shift for any traffic engineer, that now you don't design the roads for vehicles only. You design it for passengers and pedestrians and bicyclists and buses and so on. Okay, so you need to provide them with spaces and facilities and make sure they can cross safely and they have their own space and so on. So that's why we have, you must have seen that all the capacity analysis, the geometric design, the signal design, everywhere we were talking about pedestrians or bicyclists, okay, both of them or at least one of them. Then traffic calming. What is traffic calming? It happens on major roads, especially in the off-peak hours. In the peak hours, you have vehicles around you, so you don't go overboard. You are cautious yourself, okay, and your speed, you check your speed every now and then because you are following the other cars and you cannot go out of control. But in the off-peak hours, especially on major roads, wide, straight, long roads, what happens? You relax too much. You become too relaxed. Okay. So your speed, I'm not saying that you are a guy who wants to break the laws. Maybe a law-abiding driver. But since you don't have any, you don't feel any danger around you, other vehicles around you, then you tend to lose the attention towards the road and attention towards your own vehicle. Okay, so traffic calming is to make the driver more attentive, especially in terms of his speed, control his speed. Even if he is going near to the speed limit, okay, he must be checking every now and then. Okay, he must have control of the vehicle. Okay, you don't just push the accelerator and you know, relax. No, even when you are accelerating, you are also cautious that at some point of time I may have to reduce the speed as well. Okay, same thing. You observe yourself. You go on the road in the peak hour. You observe yourself. Even when you are accelerating, you are pushing the accelerator hard. You know that it's a peak hour. There are vehicles and pedestrians around me. You are ready to respond to any unexpected thing. Okay, so traffic calming is to include this mentality even in the off-peak hours. As I said, peak hours, no problem. Everybody is attentive and they are following other cars and so on. So what can we do for this traffic calming? Okay, so first of all, signal timings. So they have given the example in the book that in the off-peak hours for the major road, you may increase or reduce the green time. You may increase the red time or reduce the green time. Means the same thing, right? So that you will have a larger platoon of vehicles crossing the intersection. Because in the off-peak hour, you are coming, you know that I have more green time. So the queue will not be long even if you stand on the signal. If you have to wait for the signal to turn green, you will only have a queue of two or three vehicles. So these two or three vehicles will go very fast once they cross the signal, okay? So when you give more red time to them, you will have a longer queue, okay? So you will have a longer platoon or group of vehicle. I already discussed this term earlier as well for interrupted flow capacity. So you will have a bigger platoon of vehicles. So when they will cross intersection together, so instead of two or three vehicles, now there are 10 vehicles moving together. So they will be more cautious and their speed will be slightly less. Or you can make design changes, okay? So sometimes you just change the median width, increase or decrease at some point, just to, you know, to prick the driver, then, okay, pay attention, okay? The road is not what is used to be, that there's some change. Change the lane width, maybe introduce a curve, a small curve there, okay? You can see the examples in the book, okay? So you can introduce a curve there, okay? So, you know, just to make the driver more attentive. Again, it doesn't mean that we want the driver to, you know, just to go at 10 kilometers or 20 kilometers per hour. Okay, even he is going at the speed limit, but we want him to pay attention, okay? Obviously, the effect will be seen on his speed. His speed will be less, okay, as compared to if you don't do these things. If you don't do traffic calming, the speed will be higher. But the main thing is some drivers may still be going at design speed, but they will still be more attentive, okay? And why we want this? Because accidents happen because of unexpected things. Okay, this is to control accidents which are happening due to unexpected things. So if the driver doesn't have any traffic calming thing, any changes, long straight road without any interruption, he will relax too much. If anything unexpected comes, there is less chances that he will pay attention and he can react in time. So traffic calming is applied to cater this issue. Then we have distracted driving, okay? Now, distracted driving, drivers are getting distracted by the gadgets which you have in your vehicle. You have GPS, you have music system, you have mobiles in your hands and tablets and whatnot. Okay. In my case, kids in the car and so on. Now, let me tell you, 2 years ago, a group of students came to me and they said, we want to work on driving distractions. At that time, this book was not published. I did not teach them about driving distractions. They came with the idea themselves. They designed the whole project themselves. So I was very happy and proud of them. Okay, so maybe you can, you know, this is something to get inspired about. Okay, so now you have this issue which is, you know, highlighted in the new edition of the book. Okay, so distracted driving. Okay, so again, now traffic engineers are focusing on how to reduce this. Okay, distracted driving. So you have, you know, you cannot use mobile phones and any other distraction. If you have kids, you have to put them in the back seat and so on. Okay. So distracted driving, how to reduce the distraction of the driving. Okay. Vision zero, road to zero. Again, something which students told me earlier and then I'm looking at it in the book. Okay, road to zero means, or vision zero means having zero fatalities, zero deaths in traffic crashes. Okay, they have achieved it in some countries. I don't know for now, but at that time when the students came with that idea for the senior project, they gave the example of some countries. Scandinavian countries, maybe it was, and in addition, I think New Zealand was there and so on. So some countries have achieved Vision Zero in the past. So again, a change in priority, how to make sure even if the accidents happen, there is no death because of it. And it's a whole, you know, comprehensive plan. I will talk about it in the next lecture. Then we have connected vehicles. Connected vehicles to other vehicles or the infrastructure, V2V or V2I. V2V means vehicle to vehicle. V2I means vehicle to infrastructure. Okay. So connected vehicles, let me give an example, like you do it for your parking system, right? V2V means what? If you are too close to another vehicle, it will give you the warning, right? It will beep, it may reduce the speed. Now we have vehicles which can reduce the speed if they're too close to a danger or something. And vehicle to infrastructure, you know, you have the parking system. When you are doing the reverse parking, you have the camera. So it shows you that you are too close to other vehicle or any other object. It will again give you the sound. It will show you are in the red zone and something. Okay. So these technologies are there again to increase the safety. Driverless vehicles, we have Google cars, Tesla. So connected vehicles are a part of it. Okay. One more thing, there is technology available that if you are coming towards the signal, signal is red, the car will indicate to you and may stop itself. The signal is red. So you, even if you try, you cannot cross the red line, which is good. Okay, so driverless vehicles are part of connected vehicles, but in connected vehicles, we only consider the interaction or with the other vehicles or with the infrastructure. Okay, so they are mainly related to warning the driver. But driverless vehicles means the whole task of driving is taken up by the vehicle. Okay, so driverless vehicles are one step higher than connected vehicles. Okay, but we have the technology, right? Okay, some of the things are not so common, but the technology is there and it's approaching very fast. Then we have smartphone apps. Now, smartphone apps, as we have discussed earlier as well, mobile phones, they cause a distraction as well as help you. So GPS tracking, GPS navigation, it helps you. Okay, we have the app for traffic department. It helps you. Okay, we have in other countries, they have apps which can tell you or give you the warning if there is a congestion on the road, if there's an accident on the road, there's some construction activity on the road. Again, some 1 year ago, a group of my students did a project on this. Okay, so alhamdulillah, you guys, I'm expecting the same things from you as well, whoever comes to this field in senior design or in masters and PhD, that you will be doing something useful and new for the society. Okay. So these are the examples which I'm giving you, okay, just to inspire you. Okay. Then we have data-rich environment. So that group designed an app to indicate where do you have the construction activities happening on the road. So you want to go from place A to B, you go to that app, the app will show you which one is the best route, okay, in terms of construction activity, which route is closed and so on. Okay, so these smartphone apps can also help you as well. Then we have data-rich environment. Again, something we discussed when we were discussing data collection, traffic data collection. So you don't have to go and search for collect each and every data yourself. I gave the example for the project in Europe, where the truck company had the GPS attached to their vehicles for tracking and safety, and they gave the data to the university for, you know, for working on it. So with that data, you can calculate the speeds, you can calculate travel times, you can calculate their routes. Okay, so many things they did. Okay, and still it's, you know, I think I gave you the name as well. It was Track to Know or something like that. You can go and have a look. Okay, it's online. The data and the publication are online. Okay. So GPS data, your own GPS, your own Google Map tracks you wherever you are going. Okay, it tracks you. Okay, you are posting on Instagrams and Facebook. Went to this country, went to this hotel, went to this restaurant. It's all there. People can track you. Okay, so the data is there. We don't need that each and everything to be collected manually now. If you have access, like the trucking company gave the access, the mobile phone company, if they can give the access, there's so much data available. Okay, so there's the data environment is so rich now. Okay, we just need some access and the time to use it. Okay, the methodology and the strategies which we'll discuss in this chapter will be mainly taken from Highway Safety Manual. HSM, not HCM, okay, not Highway Capacity Manual, but Highway Safety Manual. Highway Safety Manual was developed after a series of projects taken by National Cooperative Highway Research Program, NCHRP. Okay, so after they conducted a series of research projects, they came up with this manual, and the manual was published by American Association of State Highway and Traffic Officials. ASHTO, we know ASHTO, right? We know ASHTO. But the difference is, instead of transportation, now they are saying traffic. It was transportation earlier, but now it is traffic. Okay, so note this change. So this manual was first published in 2010, and the new edition came in 2019. Okay, but the book contains the procedure from 2010, because this book was published in 2018. The manual is not considered as a standard because there are so many things around traffic accidents which you cannot control. So there are things which you have to do based upon your own judgment, your own experience, because of local conditions. So this manual is not considered as a standard, but it provides useful guidelines and equations to be used anywhere. So for example, you can use this manual for calculating crash frequency, accident frequency, with or without having historical data. With historical data, no problem. 20 accidents happened in last 5 years. You can calculate per year accident. Without historical data, that is a big issue, and they have equations for that. Predicting or estimating the effectiveness of countermeasures. So you make some improvement to reduce the number of accidents. How can I know that this improvement or this countermeasure was effective? So they have equations and methodology to do that. Evaluate the effectiveness of an implemented countermeasure. Okay, so this one was when the countermeasure is being planned, and this is after implementation. So after implementation, obviously you have the data, right? You can collect the data. So how you can make sure that the countermeasure you did was effective from the field data. So again, they have the procedure and equations to do that. So these are the main items which are included in Highway Safety Manual, and we will use it. Okay. The procedure follows these steps. First of all, gather the accident data from the whole country or the whole area. Then select the locations, do the diagnosis of the location. Diagnosis means, what is the reason? What is the reason of accident? So go to that location, look at the site conditions, look at the accidents, analyze the accident data, see how the accidents happened, why the accidents happened at that location. This is what we are calling as diagnosis. Okay, don't worry, we will discuss these steps later on in detail as well, step by step. So diagnosis means looking at the reasons of or investigating the reasons of accidents at that location. Then interpret the data and select countermeasures. Okay, so if these are the accidents, interpreting means now analyze the data and go for the countermeasures. These are the accidents, what should I do to reduce them? Okay, so then you select the countermeasures. Then in each case, you can have more than one countermeasure. You can have more than one countermeasure. So for each countermeasure, do the economic analysis, basically costing, and then do the safety analysis, safety effectiveness analysis. Okay, so maybe, for example, reducing the speed. So reducing speed, you can put a speed bump, you can put a camera, you can put a warning sign, and so on and so forth. So these are different countermeasures. Each of them will have their own cost. Then what is the effectiveness of these countermeasures in terms of reducing the accident? So maybe having a speed bump is the most expensive one, but in terms of reducing the speed and saving the accidents or saving the crashes, it is the best one. Okay, so this, again, we have already discussed, this is our primary objective. You may go for the highest cost solution because of safety. This is our duty as engineers, as professionals, and even as Muslims, to save human lives. Now, countermeasures, what are countermeasures? Any action which is taken to either to mitigate that the crash, meaning reducing the crash, or severity of the crash. Okay? So make sure either the crash doesn't happen, or if it happens, then it is less severe. People do not get hurt, they do not get killed or something. Okay. Another name given for countermeasure is treatment. Treatment, countermeasure, means the same thing. Any action which is done on the road to reduce accidents or severity of accidents. Now, countermeasures can be many, but then they have reduced them to countermeasures that work. Now, it doesn't mean that others cannot work. It means that countermeasures that work for you as a traffic engineer, countermeasures which are under your control. on which you can have some effect. But countermeasures which you can implement or you can take into your design. Okay, so these are countermeasures that work. Okay, you may have, for example, you may have accident because the window of the car was too shiny. Okay, there was sunlight on it, it shined and the accident happened. What can I do with it? Nothing. Okay, so you focus on these issues to make your life easy. So let's say alcohol and drug impaired driving. You have laws for that. You cannot do that. Seat belts and child restraints. Again, you have laws. You have to follow them. Speeding and speed management. You have speed limits, speed humps, speed cameras, so on and so forth. Distracted and drowsy driving. Again, not allowed. Not allowed. No? You cannot get. You cannot use your mobile phone. You cannot eat or drink while you're driving and so on. And so forth, right? Motorcycle safety. So you have to wear a helmet. You maybe have to wear knee pads, and there's a shape of the motorcycle you have to maintain and so on. Young drivers. We have a licensing program, learning programs, awareness programs for young drivers. Old drivers, okay, I already shown you how to tackle the old pedestrians, okay. Same thing is done for the old drivers as well. When you are saying reaction time and vision and these things, they are mainly taken for the old drivers because these are the worst cases for us, okay. So you can take their characteristics into your design. Pedestrians, okay. Pedestrian timing, signal timing, crosswalks, these things, you have to provide them. Again, then bicycle lanes, crossing time for bicycles, okay, spaces for bicycles, okay, ramps, you know, or cuts in the median for the bicycles to cross and so on. Okay, so these are all the countermeasures on which you can focus on, which you can do something, okay. And again, within each, there are certain actions you can do, okay. So speeding doesn't mean that it's one countermeasure. Under speeding, you have different actions. Okay, so I will stop here. You have another question? Accident statistics. So now they have published online, I think. Yeah. Thank you, Brian. So next year I will include them as well in the slides. Okay, so we'll have the other students will see the data up to 2019 because of Brian. So, you know, this is, you know, there's a continuous charity, right? Sadka Jariya. So thank you, Brian. Yeah, it is helpful. It is helpful. So I will save it. And this is what others can do as well. You know, you can benefit yourself as well as the others. If you, you know, go for this practice, you look for, you know, think yourself. Dua Rabi Amna Muhammad Muhammad Usama Amal Abdullah. Dua Rabi Amna Muhammad Muhammad Usama Amal Abdullah. One more thing regarding the feedback, okay, the feedback evaluation, okay, do that. It is important for us, you know, it is counted for our appraisal, our contract renewal, our evaluation, our promotion, okay. So they see it, they count it, it is taken into consideration, believe me when I said it. So if you don't want to see me, do it. If you want to see me, do it, okay. You have to do it in both cases, okay. And obviously not take much time. Okay, Usama and Amna here. Okay, we keep on giving you feedback and evaluating you. So it's time, you know, you take out your anger or whatever love you have for instructors. Muhammad Noman Ali Muhammad Hakima Ali Zahra Sayyid. Muhammad Noman Ali Muhammad Hakima Ali Zahra Sayyid. Ali Muhammad Noman Hakima Ali Zahra Sayyid. Fawaz Adil, Abdullah Jaliluddin, Abdul Rahman Ibrahim, and Nujur Salah. Fawaz Adil, Abdullah Jaliluddin, Abdul Rahman Ibrahim, Nujur Salah. Nujur, Abdul Rahman. Nadeen Hussam, Zara Riyad, Abu Bakr Ghani, Zainab Ali Ahmed. Nadeen Hussam, Zara Riyad, Abu Bakr Ghani, Zainab Ali Ahmed. Abu Bakr, Nadeen, okay. Uh, Lulwa Ibrahim, Maryam Abdul Amir, Majd Bashar, Asid Hassan. Lulwa Ibrahim, Maryam Abdul Amir, Majd Bashar, Asid Hassan. Ali Mustafa, Hamad Khalid, Abdullah Usamuddin. Ali Mustafa, Hamad Khalid, Abdullah Usamuddin. Latifa Ahmad, Fatma Abdali, Zainab Abdali, Zainab Abdulal. Latifa Ahmad, Fatma Abdali, Zainab Abdali, Zainab Abdulal. Ala Salman, Ali Abdul Razak, Elizabeth N. Ala Salman, Ali Abdul Razak, Elizabeth N. Ali Makki and Ibrahim is here. Okay, fine. Ali Makki. Ali Makki is here. Okay, people from section 1. Zahra Riyad, Fatma Ahmad, Hadir and Ahmad Amin. Okay, Hadir. Fatma. Ahmad Amin. Zahra, I didn't mark you in your section. Adil, done. I didn't mark you in section 2. You are from section 2, right, Zahra? I didn't mark you. Okay, done. Okay, thank you. Sorry.